Hello there, my name is Max, and in this video I will tell you how to solve the question about the pasteurization process. At the left top of your video screen you can see that I drawn a vessel in which we have a milk with a certain temperature which will change over time. This vessel had a certain diameter and a certain height. Now steam is flowing past it to heat up our milk, and this T as S is the temperature of the steam. And because this one is hotter than the milk, there will be a heat flow over our control volume, which is the vessel. Then we have a certain diameter, 0.44 meters, and certain height, temperature, steam, overall heat transfer coefficient, CP, a density, and we do not yet know the area of our vessel and the volume. So we are going to calculate this. And this was your first exercise. If you take a look at a cylindrical type of vessel, you can look up how to calculate the area, but you can also just look at it and see that you need 2 times the area of the bottom plus the area of the shell. Well, the area of the bottom is exactly the same as the area of a circle, which is 2 times P times the radius squared, and the area of a shell is the height times the outline of a circle, which is 2P times the radius. Well, they have given me a diameter, so I will change those ones, which is 1/4 times d squared plus h2p times the and half best radius. So, and now just fill in your numbers and you will see that you will get 1.24 square meters. Well, we also have to calculate the volume. The volume of a cylindrical vessel is the same as the area of the bottom times the height. It's just the same way as you would do for a cube. So the area of the bottom of the cube times the height. So we have the volume, which is P times radius squared times H, which is the same as P times 1/4 D squared times height. Fill in those numbers as well. You will find that the volume of a vessel is somewhere like 100 liters. Well, that's perfect. Then we were talking about Newton's Cooling's Law and that it could be applied on this situation. So how would that one look like? So the flow in Newton's Cooling's Law is equal to the area of which the flow goes over times the overheat coefficients times delta T. And delta T in this case is the difference between the steam and your milk. And we were asking this question since we are looking for an expression for the T of the milk over time, which somewhat looks like a constant plus a constant times the exponent of a constant times T. And then we particularly asked to calculate gamma, which is that one. Well, how to solve this is always balancing. So in week 2, we have already seen what we can do with the thermal energy balance. And we are going to use the thermal energy balance here as well. Why the thermal energy balance? Since the temperature is changing, we can rewrite this to a delta of temperature. So we are going to do this. So we have a delta of internal energy over time, and that changes, as you have learned in week 2, with a inflow of internal energy minus an outflow of internal energy plus a inflow of heat. And this is exactly what we see over here happening, plus the production of internal energy, which can be somewhat like a reaction. Well, The vessel is closed with no inflow, no outflow. We have a FUQ, a heat flow, and we have no reactions or no production. So this makes it a lot easier than it should look on the first sight. And then we can rewrite the du dt term, since you can also write d little u times m. And then we have internal energy over mass times mass is still du dt. And we can rewrite m as the density times our volume, since we have those already calculated. And then we can rewrite the u as Cp times t. So I can do Cp times t. And of course, this is all of the milk, since we are looking at the milk inside of the vessel, over dt. And this is still our heat flow. Well, let me reorder things for you so we can get rho times v times Cp out of the bracket, since those do not change over time, but the temperature does. And then take a look at Vq, which is equal to Newton's cooling law, the area times the overall heat coefficients times delta T. And if we take a close look at delta T, this is the T of the steam minus T of the milk, which changes over time. If I reorder all of this, I get the dT over this delta T term is equal to area times overall heat coefficient divided by rho times V times Cp times dT. And of course, integrate. You have done this before, but I will do it for you now. So the left hand side will be minus ln Ts minus T is this whole thing just times the time plus the constant. Do not forget this. Well, rewrite this again and you will see that we get something we are looking for actually, which is Ts minus the temperature is a new constant times this one and times, and then we have this at the top. And we write this again for temperature. We get Ts minus K2 times E over all these constants times T. Minus. I forgot the minus over there. And if we take a look at what we were looking for, so we're looking for this gamma. And if you can see now, this is alpha, this is beta, and this is gamma. So this was the right answer. Then we wanted to know how long it would take for the milk to become 72 degrees Celsius. And for this, we had to fill in an initial condition. And you were asked which one was the correct one. Well, you take a look at what is T at time is zero. T is zero. And you will see this is 25 degrees Celsius. But for now, let's call it T0. So if I fill this in my equation, so I fill this in this equation, then I can find that our constant K2 was Ts minus T0. I will not calculate or show this to you right now, but if you do the math at home, you can see that I am correct. So then our total equation will be T is the T of steam minus, between bracket, the T of steam minus T0, so the difference between the steam and the milk at time is zero, the exponential, the area times the internal heat transfer coefficient times rho times V times Cp times T. And this is our final equation for the temperature of the milk over time. We know every one of these quantities what their numbers are. So we can just fill them in, and we have now a relationship between the temperature of the milk and the time. And if you fill in the numbers, you can calculate it, and the time for the milk to reach 72 degrees Celsius is 749 seconds, which is the same as 12.5 minutes. And this is all, guys. I hope this helped you in the better understanding of this exercise. And if you still have any questions, please do not hesitate and place them on the forum. Maybe your fellow students can help you, and otherwise we can. Have a good time and good luck with this second subunit.